a testimony, and I've shared it at other places, and I came to Andrew, and I said, you know, can I come and talk about my kidneys, you know, because, and there's a whole story behind that, because I really didn't want to, but I feel like this is what God is teaching me, and as he and I were on the phone this week, and he was sharing about what he was teaching on, and what I had been, what my story was all about, we said, it's the same message, so God has been orchestrating this. It wasn't that I've just made up my story to fit his. No, this is just really happening with me. So thank you for letting me come share with you. I feel like I need to give you some context first. I was diagnosed with kidney disease 2 years ago. Last year I was put on the kidney transplant wait list, and this year I started dialysis. So CKD, chronic kidney disease, is a very misleading disease because I know that I look really normal. I feel good. There was a time when I was feeling pretty sick, but I'm doing good now. But, you know, really, if you came, you would not know that I was sick. But my body is really just kind of hanging on. My kidneys, they're back here, they're functioning at 4%, and I get regular injections. I take about 15 different medications every day, and every night I hook myself up to a dialysis machine, and for 8.5 hours it runs, and it removes toxins from my body. And so that's how I stay alive, all the while I'm looking for a kidney donor. So I'm here, and like I said, you know, it was really hard to come here. I did not want to come here. I didn't want to go anywhere. And I did not want to have to talk about my kidneys. But I think I'm starting to see that God is teaching me about just getting out there and being open about my needs. You know, not just about the kidneys, but just my life. To kind of take on this posture of receiving, which is just so uncomfortable. You know, it took me losing my sixth donor. I had six people who kind of went through the testing process. Sixth donor come and just not make it through the process before I realized, okay, God. You know, before that, I just kind of thought, enough people know the prayer team at church, the friends and families, that's good enough, you know. But I felt like God was saying, you kind of need to keep getting out there. And I said, no. And so it took losing, you know, that many donors for me to finally said, okay, let me call Andrew, let me call, you know, other people. And so I've been sharing at different places, and I have more places to share. And so it's hard, but I'm finding that when you kind of step forward and do what God's clearly telling you to do, there's a new freedom. There's good things that are happening. And yes, people are blessing me, people are encouraging me, but I'm finding that God is surprising me in other ways. So there's really kind of two big lessons I wanted to share with you today. The one is to let my community in, to open myself even more than what I was doing, and to keep on doing that, which is hard because I think we live in a culture that prides herself on being self-sufficient, and I think it's so ingrained in our Asian culture especially. We never want to impose on people, right? I wrote about that in my blog, so please read my blog. And I talked about that, and somebody came up to me after and said, you know, I read your website, and I don't think it's just Asians that don't want to impose on people. I really think it's just everybody. All cultures are like that. And I just kind of nodded, and I thought, no, I think for Asians it's way more so. And then I realized later, I didn't tell her because I didn't want to impose my opinion on her, you know, that would have sounded like I was disagreeing with her, and I don't want to come off sounding like I think she's wrong, you know. I don't like making people feel uncomfortable. And here I was really, I have this really huge ask. I have this really huge need. And I don't like imposing, but this is about as imposing as you can be. But God says, this is at the core of my relationship with you. This is at the core of the gospel message. God sent Jesus to save us. But really, only those of us who admit we need the help, only those of us who understand, we can't fix ourselves. We can't earn our way to salvation. So we need our community, and we need God. We need something outside of ourselves. God was saying also that crises, it's not just about my kidneys, crises have a way of magnifying whatever other issues you have going on. So whatever stress you have, when stress is entering your life, you're going to be challenged emotionally, mentally, relationally. That's a hard one. Marty and I are seeing a therapist, and I realize I probably just made some of you a little bit uncomfortable because we don't talk about that, especially in the Asian church. And he knows that I'm sharing this, so don't go up to him and say, I can't believe she said that out loud. But we are, and it's been really good. And when we first shared our news with our church, and you know, our pastor said, you know, Marty, Doris, it would be a really good idea if you guys go see couples counseling. And it wasn't that she saw anything in particular that raised concern, but I think she just understands this is the condition of the human heart. When things come in, we're going to need help to navigate our way through what was going to be a really stressful season in our life. And how do we do that in a way that's healthy and in a way that keeps us together and keeps us growing? So it's been good. And as I have been sharing with people that, we're going through this stuff, the kidneys, the emotional stuff, all this other stuff that comes along with it, it's been good because other people have shared with me their stories of crises. If you're not going through a crisis, somebody near you is, it's just all over. And so there's a freedom when we come with, you know, what we have. I know it's uncomfortable, but God has just been so good. So yes, learning to let my community in, because I think so much of what God wants to teach us happens in the context of community. And it's just kind of, we just miss out if we don't kind of open ourselves up to that. I had this picture of, whenever my family and my extended family, especially my brother and the kids, and we get together with my mom always pays. But there was a time, when we said, Mom, it's okay, let us pay now. We're grown kids now. It's our church to take care of you. And we kept pushing that because I felt like that was being the good daughter. And then one day she just shot back and she said, stop it. I want to treat you guys, And I just feel like you guys, I just want you guys to say, yay, thank you, Papa is treating, and just to enjoy it. And then I realized she was actually kind of annoyed that we weren't accepting this gift from her. And I think God is so much like that. God really just wants to give us what we feel like. God, we have the gift of salvation, thank you, but the rest of our life, we just feel like we have to fix ourselves, and whenever we have problems or we have trouble forgiving someone, or we have trouble with depression, we just gotta get it together because those people look like they are, and so we need to do it to get ourselves together. But God is saying, eternal life starts now. It's not just when you die and go to heaven. Eternal life starts now. I have a relationship with you now, and I want to give to you now. I have lots of blessings. It's not just giving you what you need, it's giving you all the good stuff too, for you to live a life that's full of joy and have my supernatural peace and to have purpose. All that I want to give you, but you just kind of have to get into this posture of being able to receive. So God is teaching me to do that. It's been, it took me a little while to kind of get here, but it's been good. So, and I'm really just kind of enjoying what God is doing. So letting my community in. The second thing I wanted to share was there's this theme that keeps on playing over and over in my life this past 2 years, and it's the idea that it's never the end of the story. So what do I mean by that? If you've been following my blog, you know that the past 2 years have been like a constant stream of good news and bad news and good and bad, and I have a donor, I lost my donor, and then I had, at one point I had lesions on my kidneys, and then second ultrasound, they're bigger, and so more tests, and the MRI, no, they're fine, they're harmless. One of the worst was being told that I had a genetic form of the disease, and that there was a good possibility that my kids had CKD as well. So that was really hard. So I was told, go talk to the pediatrician, they need to watch out for this, go get the life insurance, and months down the line, I get a second opinion, and no, I don't have that form of the disease. So it was just like constantly one thing after another. And I remember being hit with some bad news one day, and I found myself thinking, it's okay. It's not the end of the story, because anything can happen. So just rest in God and ride through this. And so I just felt like I was learning to let go of the circumstances and realizing that circumstances really did not need to power that I was giving it. The flip side, of course, is also when things are good, I can celebrate, but then I thought, yeah, but you know what, anything can happen, so don't celebrate too long. And it wasn't that I was being cynical, it wasn't that I was starting to kind of become numb to it all. I think I was just starting to realize circumstances really aren't that relevant. At the end of the day, God is the only thing that doesn't change, and He was starting to show me that circumstances never define how good God is. Whether things are good, whether things are bad, they're never an indication of how good God is. He's just good all the time. When I lost my first donor, that was really hard because we had gone so far in the testing process, and everything was going really well. And he had been praying about this decision. His church had been praying for him and for me, and we thought this was where God was answering all those prayers. And then at the 11th hour, it just all fell apart. And I thought, I was just like in shock. I just thought, in shock, but also confused, because I felt like, how is it that God leads you down this road and then He does something really different? Like, well, so was this not God? Was I praying for nothing? Is He even really there? But, so it was just kind of a trying time. So that had just happened. I came home one day, about 2 days after that had all happened, and I got a card in the mail, and it says, "Don't be discouraged. We're praying for you. God is good." And I thought, how did she know? She didn't know. It was a God thing. God knew exactly what I needed to hear, when I needed to hear it, and so that was God showing up when I needed it. 5 months later, the exact same thing happened, and I just couldn't believe my luck. I just thought, this was a decision bathed in prayer, and this person was healthy, and everything, all the doors were opening, and at the 11th and a half hour, even, I mean, we had gone as far as setting a transplant date and talking to the surgeon, and then it just all fell apart again, and I thought, God, this can't. What are you doing? Again, being very discouraged and shocked. And by this time, I was feeling really weary, emotionally tired, because it wasn't just all the donors coming and going. It was all the ultrasounds and the MRIs and the constant blood draws and tired of being poked by a needle. At that point, I think the hardest part was feeling like, now what? I was lucky. Most people are lucky to get one living donor. I got two, and I lost them both, and I have no one, in the wings. So now what? And then I came home, and 2 days later, I got a voicemail on my phone, and it was someone that I didn't know that well, but someone who said, Doris, I heard you had kidney disease. I don't know if you still need a donor. I want to get tested. So I thought, this was God showing up again. And, it didn't change, everything, and not that circumstances, didn't change a whole lot, but I knew that God was meeting me just when I needed it, to remind me that I promised you I would not forsake you, I would not abandon you. You are not forgotten. So hang on to that, and I will be there. I know you guys have been praying. I know that you feel like, well, God, why don't you just answer? Because that's what you said, in the Bible, that you would come and meet all our needs, and you're not doing that. But I think He's saying, in my time, and I know, I don't know if He will provide a donor, but there's a sense of God saying, there are blessings that you will miss out on if I answered your prayer the way you wanted to the first time. There are other things that I have yet to show you. And so He has. I'm definitely growing in faith. I feel like I'm more connected with people now, because as I share my story, other people are sharing their story. There's lots of stories out there. I know I'm not the only one. And so all that has just been so good. I'm learning to let go of circumstances, and learning to let go, like, all those things, my insecurities and the things that really don't even worry about them. Hang on to the important things. It's Friday, I just went to my high school reunion, my 30th high school reunion. So, and that was really fun, but I didn't want to go, and I, And I had not been to any of my reunions, and you know why? It was because I always felt like I had nothing to show. I always felt kind of inadequate, that I was going to show up and people were going to have all their amazing careers, and that I really felt like I didn't accomplish a whole lot. But I think because I was in this season of life where God was teaching me to let go of those insecurities and let go of those inadequacies and to say, God, this is who I am. And you know, as I'm doing that, there's a whole new freedom. And I had such a good time. I was like, we should have another reunion, you know? I'm just so happy to see everybody. And I'm finding that, you know, when I just kind of tell people, and I didn't go to tell people about this, but it was just a great time connecting with people. And it was just good to hear about everybody else too. So yes, I'm learning it's not the end of the story. God is always there, and God will always, you know, watch over me. A couple of months ago, a friend texted me on a Sunday night. She said, you know, today at church service, the pastor gave like really amazing benediction at the end. He said, may the God who defends you on all sides go with you. This was so good because, you know, God was working in the people around me to just really come and support me. But God was doing something here, too. He was giving me a kind of a peace that really surpasses all understanding, like it says in Philippians. And so I do have a God who is defending me from discouragement, and he's defending me from hopelessness. And it's not all the time. You know, usually in the middle of the night when I kind of wake up sometimes, I think, and I start thinking. Thinking can be really dangerous, and that gets a little bit hard for me, but I kind of keep coming back to this, and I kind of look at my life, and I realize, you know what? When I lost my first donor, that was hard. When I lost my second donor, that was hard. Two weeks ago, I just lost my sixth donor, and I'm okay. I felt like, God, you're making that faith muscle stronger. It's getting stronger, and I have this peace. That makes no sense, you know, but I'll take it. And I have this joy that is his strength. So, and I'm learning to get connected to the community. So God's been good. So no, I don't know what my future looks like right now, but I think God's doing some good.